stuff now? Raymond stuff?
No, Samson.
Oh, Samson? Oh, he comes by my store a lot.
When Samson is loose, when he breaks away, they look for him at our house.
Samson.
He hears her coming by and cries, and she hears him, and then we can't go by the house.
Who's Samson?
That's an energetic dog in neighborhood. You're up.
Yeah.
No more digressions.
No. I think Theodore, well, getting at the...
172B.
Yeah, 172B.
Well, actually, wait a minute, want to do it 172C, we can skip that, we did that last time. 172C.
Theodore's, what's that to be?
But one theory after another is coming upon us, Theodore's.
Yeah.
And the last is more important than the one before. Theodore's.
Well, Socrates, we have plenty of leisure, have we not?
Apparently we have. And that makes me think, my friend, as I have often done before, how natural it is that those who have spent a long time in the study of philosophy appear ridiculous when they enter the courts of law as speakers.
What do you mean?
Those who have knocked about in courts and the like from their youth up seem to me, when compared to those who have been brought up in philosophy and similar pursuits, to be as slaves in breeding compared with freemen.
In what way is this the case?
In this way. The latter always have that which you just spoke of, leisure, and the talk of their leisure and peace, just as we now, taking up argument after argument, already beginning a third. So can they, if, as in our case, a new one pleases them better than that in which they are engaged. And they do not care at all whether their talk is long or short, if only they attain the truth. But the men of the other sort are always in a hurry, for the water flowing through the water clock moves them.
Can you do that again?
But the men of the other sort are always in a hurry, for the water flowing through the water clock urges them on. In different translations. And the other party in the suit does not permit them to talk about anything they please, but stands over them exercising the law's compulsion by reading the brief, from which no deviation is allowed. This is called the affidavit. And the discourse is always about a fellow slave who is addressed to a master who sits there holding some case or other in his hands, and the contest never run an indefinite course, but are always directed to the point at issue, and often the races for the defendant's life. As a result of all this, the speakers become tense and shrewd. They know how to wheedle their master with words and gain his favor by acts. But in their souls, they become small and warped, for they have been deprived of growth and straightforwardness and independence by the slavery they have endured from their youth up. For this forces them to do crooked acts by putting a great burden of fears and dangers upon their souls while these are still tender. And since they cannot bear this burden with uprightness and truth, they turn forthwith to deceit and to requiting wrong with wrong, so that they become greatly bent and stunted. Consequently, they pass their youth for manhood with no soundness of mind in them, but they think they have become clever and wise. So much for them, Theodorus. Shall we describe those who belong to our band, or shall we let that go and return to the argument in order to avoid abuse of that freedom and variety of discourse of which we were speaking just now?
By all means, Socrates, describe them. For I like your saying that we who belong to this band are not the servants of our arguments, but the arguments are, as it were, our servants, and each of them must await our pleasure to be finished. For we have neither judge nor, as the poets have, any spectator set over us to censor and rule us.
Very well. That is quite appropriate, since it is your wish. And let us speak of the leaders, for why should anyone talk about the inferior philosophers? The leaders, in the first place, from the youth up, remain ignorant of the way to the agora, do not even know where the courtroom is, or the senate house, or any other public place of assembly. As for laws and decrees, they neither hear the debates upon them, nor see them when they are published. And the strivings of political clubs after public offices, and meetings, and banquets, and revelings with chorus girls, it never occurs to them even in their dreams to indulge in such things. And whether anyone in the city is of high or low birth, or what evil has been inherited by anyone from his ancestors, male or female, are matters to which they pay no more attention than to the number of pints in the sea, as the saying is. And all these things the philosopher does not even know that he does not know. For he does not keep aloof from them for the sake of gaining reputation. But really, it is only his body that has its place and home in the city. His mind, considering all these things petty and of no account, disdains them, and is borne in all the directions. As Pindar says, both below the earth, measuring the surface of the earth, and above the sky, studying the stars, and investigating the universal nature of everything that is, each in its entirety, never lowering itself to anything close at hand.
What do you mean by this, Socrates?
Why, take the case of Thales, Theodorus. While he was studying the stars and looking upwards, he fell into a pit, and a neat, witty Thracian servant girl jeered at him, they say, because he was so eager to know the things in the sky that he could not see what was there before him at his very feet. The same just applies to all who pass their lives in philosophy. For really, such a man pays no attention to his next-door neighbor. He is not only ignorant of what he is doing, but he hardly knows whether he is a human being or some other kind of a creature. But what a human being is, and what is proper for such a nature to do or bear, different from any other, this he inquires and exerts himself to find out. Do you understand, Theodorus, or not?
Yes, I do. You're right.
Hence it is, my friend, such a man, both in private when he meets with individuals and in public, as I said in the beginning, when he is obliged to speak in court or elsewhere about the things at his feet and before his eyes, is a laughingstock, not only to Thracian girls, but to the multitude in general. For he falls into pits and all sorts of perplexities through inexperience, and his awkwardness is terrible, making him seem a fool. But when it comes to abusing people, he has no personal abuse to offer against anyone because he knows no evil of any man, never having cared for such things. So his perplexity makes him appear ridiculous. And as to laudatory speeches and the boastings of others, it becomes manifest that he is laughing at them, not pretending to laugh, but really laughing. And so he is thought to be a fool. When he hears a panegyric of a despot or a king, he fancies he is listening to the praises of some herdsman, a swineherd, or a shepherd, or another person, who gets much milk from his beasts. But he thinks that the ruler tends and milks a more perverse and treacherous creature than the herdsman, and that he must grow coarse and uncivilized no less than they. For he has no leisure and lives surrounded by a wall, as the herdsmen live in their mountain pens. And when he hears that someone is amazingly rich because he owns 10,000 acres of land or more, to him, accustomed as he is to think of the whole earth, this seems very little. And when people sing the praises of lineage and say someone is of noble birth because he can show 7 wealthy ancestors, he thinks that such praises betray an altogether dull and narrow vision on the part of those who utter them. Because of lack of education, they cannot keep their eyes fixed upon the whole, and are unable to calculate that every man has had countless thousands of ancestors and progenitors, among whom have been in any instance rich and poor, kings and slaves, barbarians and Greeks. And when people pride themselves on a list of 25 ancestors and can trace their pedigree back to Heracles, the son of Amphitryon, the pettiness of their ideas seems absurd to him. He laughs at them because they cannot free their silly minds of vanity by calculating that Amphitryon's 25th ancestor was such a fortune happened to make him, and the 50th for that matter. In all these cases, a philosopher is derided by the common herd, partly because he seems to be contemptuous, partly because he is ignorant of common things and is always in perplexity.
That all happens just as you say, Socrates.
But when, my friend, he draws a man upward and the other is willing to rise with him above the level of what wrong have I done you or you me, to the investigation of abstract right and wrong, to inquire what each of them is and wherein they differ from each other and from all other things, or above the level of is a king happy, or on the other hand, has he great wealth, to the investigation of royalty and of human happiness and wretchedness in general, to see what the nature of each is and in what way man is naturally fitted to gain the one and escape the other. When that man of small and sharp and pettifogging mind is compelled in his turn to give an account of all these things, then the tables are turned. Is he by the new experience of hanging at such a height? He gazes down from the air in dismay and perplexity. He stammers. It becomes ridiculous not in the eyes of Thracian girls or other uneducated persons, for they have no perception of it. But in those of all men who have been brought up as free men, not as slaves. Such is the character of each of the two classes, Theodorus, of the man who has truly been brought up in freedom and leisure, whom we call a philosopher, who may without censure appear foolish and good for nothing, but he is involved in menial services if, for instance, he does not know how to pack up his bedding, much less to put the proper sweetening into a sauce or a fawning speech. and of the other who can perform all such services smartly and quickly, but does not know how to wear his cloak as a freeman should, properly draped, still less to acquire the true harmony of speech, and him aright the praises of the true life of gods and blessed men.
If, Socrates, you could persuade all men of the truth of what you say as you do me, there would be more peace and fewer evils among mankind.
But it is impossible that evil should be done away with, Theodorus. For there must always be something opposed to the good. And they cannot have their place among the gods, but must inevitably hover about mortal nature in this earth. Therefore, we ought to try to escape from earth to the falling of the gods as quickly as we can. And to escape is to become like God, so far as this is possible. And to become like God is to become righteous, holy, and wise. But indeed, my good friend, it is not at all easy to persuade people that the reason generally advanced for the pursuit of virtue and the avoidance of vice, namely in order that a man may not seem bad and may seem good, is not the reason why the one should be practiced and the other not. That, I think, is merely old wives' chatter, as the saying is. Let us give the true reason. God is in no wise and in no manner unrighteous, but utterly and perfectly righteous, and there is nothing so like him as that one of us who in turn becomes most nearly perfect in righteousness. It is herein that the true cleverness of a man is found, and also his worthlessness and cowardice. The knowledge of this is wisdom, or true virtue, and the ignorance of it is folly, or manifest wickedness. And all the other kinds of seeming cleverness and wisdom are paltry when they appear in public affairs and vulgar in the arts. Therefore, by far the best thing for the unrighteous man and the man whose words or deeds are impious is not to grant that he is clever through knavery, for such men glory in that reproach, and think it means that they are not triflers, useless burdens upon the earth, but such as men should be who are to live safely in a state. So we must tell them the truth, that just because they do not think they are such as they are so all the more truly. For they do not know the penalty of unrighteousness, which is a thing they must not know. For it is not what they think it is, scourgings and death, which they sometimes escape entirely when they have done wrong, but a penalty which it is impossible to escape.
What penalty do you mean?
Two patterns, my friend, are set up in the world, the divine, which is most blessed, and the godless, which is most wretched. But these men do not see that this is the case, and their silliness and extreme foolishness blind them to the fact that through their unrighteous acts, they are made like the one, unlike the other. They therefore pay the penalty for this by living a life that conforms to the pattern they resemble. And if we tell them that, unless they depart from that cleverness, the blessed place that is pure of all evil things, of all things evil, will not receive them after death, and here on earth they will always live the life like themselves, evil men associating with evil, when they hear this, they will be so confident in their unscrupulous cleverness that they will think our words the talk of fools.
Very true, Socrates.
Yes, my friend, I know. However, there is one thing that has happened to them. Whenever they have to carry out a personal argument about the doctrines to which they object, if they are willing to stand their ground for a while like men, and do not run away like cowards, then, my friend, they at last become strangely dissatisfied with themselves and their arguments. Their good rhetoric withers away, so that they seem no better than children. But this is a digression. Let us turn away from these matters if we do not feel we'll come on like an ever-rising flood and bury in silk our original argument. And let us, if you please, proceed.
To me, Socrates, such digressions are quite as agreeable as the argument, for they are easier for a man of my age to follow. However, if you prefer, let us return to our argument.
Right there.
Got a good piece
feeling. I expect it's going to be fun.
What you doing?
Huh?
What you doing?
She's just happy she got it.
And she was running before you changed your mind.
That's how I usually do it. It's a way. Okay. What's the order? What's going on? Can we break it up into parts? What's the division? What's going on?
Well, he does it backwards, it seems to me. In other words, that he ends with what I think may be the beginning, but I mean, that's his method. He starts in the particular with the two types of men that fall into the two groups. He tells about the history of the two. Gives some background. How they came in to be the way they were. What they do. How they are examples of the two groups. And ends up with the two patterns. So he's going from the specific to the general. Same for me.
Okay. Okay, let's consider that. Anyone want to add that, or that's it?
Well, what their history and background, and what the consequences are on their soul, given their education and their upbringing. And how one, as a result of this upbringing, becomes a slave and the other becomes a freeman.
The effect of one being in one environment and the other's environment.
Also, I think this is the first place that he's been able to present, you know, one of the patterns. All along, we've been talking about Pythagorean position, and there has been no mention of the philosopher's position as to how it may be different or opposed. And this is the first indication of that, where Socrates has been able to lay the two down side by side.
Her mother usually takes care of her.
Yeah, right. That's why you can tell she doesn't.
I don't know if she's that fast.
Oh. She can be out the front door in a second.
Okay.
There are as many points here as there are arguments. Go ahead, where?
Appears that there are many parts, subparts, or many subjects that there are. Excuse me, Socrates between the comments of Theodorus.
Yeah. Okay, I thought you were making some other point. All right, someone else? Anyone else?
Well, he's, Theodorus is putting himself into the group of philosophers, doesn't he?
Mm-hmm.
We who belong to this family.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's anyone wants to add something later. We'll add. All right. Does that help us with this question? Roger.
Why the digression?
Yeah, should we use the old procedure? Trusted.
Sure.
All right. Barbara, you tell us. Right, David?
Sounds good.
Why should we worry about it?
When do we have an intellectual?
I don't see that it helps us with the question. How's that funny? What specifically?
The early dialogue of the theater, those were found soon after this original dialogue took place. The digression wasn't planned in.
So you're trying to determine.
It's just added by one of the slaves. Yeah. They didn't know what else to do with one of these things, so they just stuck it in between.
I thought it was a computer enhancement.
No. Carol.
It's a good one.
Okay, then look here. You should be able to reread it and check off each of these things. And then we could put next to it the particular lines in the text, and there should be nothing left over. Sure. Right. If it is, it would be irrelevant. No, not necessarily.
Well, I don't know.
Well, I think that might be a way to go. Try it and see.
We better add instruction up there, too.
What?
Instruction.
Instruction.
Wait. Yeah, and hold. That's a pretty big point. He's talking about the consequences of virtue and vice.
Yeah. Okay.
Wisdom, folly.
Yeah, that's why I made these big points.
Is that that's why? Yeah.
Say, what is the question we've been exploring in this dialogue?
I believe it's something like knowledge. What is knowledge?
What is knowledge?
What is knowledge, Deities? Again, from the 14th back.
It's the veterinarian's art.
Just for a second, let's go back to 146. Tell me then, you're learning some geometry from Theodorus.
Yes.
And astronomy? And harmonics? And arithmetic? I certainly do my best to learn. So do I, from him and from anyone else who seems to understand these things. I do modestly well in general, but all the same, puzzled about one small matter which you and your friends must help me to think out. Tell me, is it not true that learning about something means becoming wiser in that matter?
Yeah.
Of course. And what makes people wise is wisdom, I suppose? Yeah. And is that in any way different from knowledge? Is what different? wisdom. Are not people wise in the things in which they have knowledge? Certainly. Then knowledge and wisdom are the same thing. Yes. That is precisely what I am puzzled about. I cannot make out to my own satisfaction what knowledge is. Can we answer that question? What do you say? Which of us will speak first? Everyone who misses shall sit down and be donkey, as the children say when they're playing at ball. Anyone who gets through without missing shall be king. Have the right to make us answer any question he likes. Why are you so silent? I hope Theodora said my passion for argument is not making me ill-mannered in my eagerness to start a conversation and has set us all at ease with one another like friends. What's he puzzled about? I cannot make out to my own satisfaction what knowledge is. I'm precisely puzzled. You know, that's precisely what I'm puzzled about. What's that? Then knowledge and wisdom are the same thing. Theaetetus, yes. Well, that is precisely what I am puzzled about. I cannot make out to my own satisfaction what knowledge is.
The reference was right there. That's what you just agreed to.
So, okay, well, you agree. He reveals this. He says, you know what? Knowledge. Not knowledge and wisdom. That's the same thing. Same thing. Yes. That's precisely what I'm puzzled about. I can't make out for the life of me what knowledge is.
But it's like,
what does he leave open?
Define.
He's puzzled.
Defining
knowledge.
No.
He's puzzled that he doesn't know.
What
if
you're
the same,
is?
He's puzzled he doesn't know.
What? What wisdom is? What about
him? What wisdom is?
What about what wisdom? What is? How would you put it?
Perfect righteousness.
Oh, okay. Let me ask you again. That.
Okay.
He starts out by saying, "Hey, then knowledge and wisdom are the same thing." He says. That's precisely what I'm puzzled about. I can't make out to my satisfaction what knowledge is. What does that mean he is not puzzled about?
What was
what
this is what he's puzzled about. This, right? That's Socrates. Everybody, right? Most everybody would say there is any difference between the two because wisdom is being knowledgeable about the things that you know.
Well, that's just what he said, wiser in things that you know.
Yeah.
He said, yeah.
Yeah. Everyone would go on. Right? And when you ask people, right, it's exactly the reverse, isn't it? If you push them, they may say, wait, I'm not sure about this, but this I'm sure, not this I'm secure about. It's exactly the opposite, isn't it?
Yeah. Wisdom is some type of magic or something that is.
Yeah. So look here. Subject matter? What does he cover in the digression? Yeah, what's he cover in the digression? In terms of the basic issue in the dialogue about what is nature and knowledge and Socrates is public.
He covers courage in there.
Mm-hmm.
Two different kinds of ignorance.
Ignorance?
What the philosopher tries to find out and is concerned with and thinks what is worth investigating.
Hmm.
distinct character types, and which it is the more beneficial to follow.
Yeah. What's that got to do with all that stuff? Does the sophist or the rhetorician, is he intent on giving the appearance of knowledge?
No, Mommy!
Does he want to rest here?
Sure.
This is where he wants to rest. Yeah. Does everything he can to get there, to be there, give the appearance of knowledge. And therefore he thinks it's real, right?
Oh, no, Mommy!
He thinks this is real.
He thinks something is real.
Yeah, knowledge. He's not fussy about it.
No, he's not fussy about it.
He wants to, right? He thinks this is real. He seeks it.
Yeah, that's
pays money to learn.
Gives the, right?
That's what I think he thinks.
Pays to learn.
Practices it.
Right? Practices it. Right? Gives the appearance of it. Right, he's learning. He's in there, isn't he? He's in it. Hi.
For the Lord. This is a trial, Lord.
Okay. Well, and this is what Socrates is puzzled about. This is his puzzle.
It's a copy.
Right. And this is what Protagoras says everybody has. There's no puzzle about it. He's got a theory of it. Everybody has it. And having it means that no one is particularly wiser than another.
So what the discussion is between knowledge itself and the appearance of knowledge, then.
Well, the appearance of knowledge, certainly.
Is there anything in the digression that deals with wisdom?
Of course.
So I'll give you a bunch of it.
You
can't say the whole.
Page 129,
I'll take it. What do you got? What number along the side?
176b. We ought to try to escape from earth to the dwelling of the God as quickly as we can, and to escape is to become like God, so far as this is possible, and to become like God is to become righteous and holy and wise. Does that mean anything?
Well, there's no doubt about that. That's there, isn't it? Right?
And then it goes on down.
Yeah, why don't you keep reading?
176C.
Yeah, why don't you keep reading?
The whole thing?
Well, where you just left off.
Okay. But indeed, my good friend, it is not at all easy to persuade people that the reason generally advanced for the pursuit of virtue and the avoidance of vice, namely in order that a man may not seem bad and may seem good, is not the reason why the one should be practiced and the other not. That, I think, is merely old wives' chatter, as the saying is. Let us give the true reason. God is in no wise and in no manner unrighteous, but utterly and perfectly righteous. And there is nothing so like him as that one of us who in turn becomes most nearly perfect in righteousness. It is herein that the true cleverness of a man is found, and also his worthlessness and cowardice. For the knowledge of this is wisdom, or true virtue, and ignorance of it is folly,
Mommy,
or manifest wickedness. And
Mommy,
all these, okay?
Yeah, do it. The last sentence.
Pardon me? The last sentence?
Yeah, what you just read. Yeah.
It is herein that the true cleverness of a man is found, and also his worthlessness and cowardice. For the knowledge of this is wisdom, or true virtue, and ignorance of it
is folly or manifest wickedness. And all the other kinds of seeming cleverness and wisdom are paltry when they appear in public affairs and vulgar in the arts.
Please, clearly, that falls right there, doesn't it? Right, the subject. Other translations, please.
I have the load, I'm sorry.
Remember what the question we have up here that Socrates just asked over there?
What is knowledge?
What is knowledge?
Right, whether or not they're the same.
He can say that last sentence. He says what wisdom is, so.
Does he link the two of them?
That's right.
The knowledge of this is wisdom.
Look, the knowledge of this is wisdom.
Yeah.
Is he linking the two of them together?
On page 127.
Remember? On the side?
Okay, it's 175 between D, almost to E. Socrates says, dizzy by the new experience of hanging at such a height, he gazes downward from the air in dismay and perplexity. He stammers and becomes ridiculous, not in the eyes of Thracian girls or other uneducated persons, for they have no perception of it. Yes. If Theaetetus is saying knowledge is perception,
puts him in a collapse.
Keep going.
I don't know where to go with it, but the word perception there just...
Well, just come. Read the last sentence.
But in those of all men who have been brought up as free men, not as slaves.
Now it is. They will not see what is happening.
Right.
What is yours, sir?
They have no perception of it.
Therefore, in the theory that knowledge is perception.
Well, then they're not knowledgeable.
There's some things that
perceive it.
Not perceive. Or some people aren't going to be able to see this. Right. Only a certain, in other words, knowledge, oh no, push it a step further. Would he then say from that passage that knowledge is not perception?
Yeah.
So read it again.
Okay.
Same.
Other uneducated personally. He stammers and becomes ridiculous. Not in the eyes of Thracian girls or other uneducated persons, for they have no perception of it.
Mm-hmm. So there's a group of people that have no perception of something. Keep going.
But in those of all men who have been brought up as free men, not as slaves.
Okay. Are there two groups of people being contrasted?
Mm-hmm.
What marks the difference between them?
Well, the slaves are uneducated.
What else? Since they're uneducated, what follows?
can follow so that they can't see.
Hmm. Is there another group?
Mm-hmm.
And what marks them? One group you found them. What were the two terms?
Three men and slaves.
And one group you said was uneducated, and what else?
Uneducated and they can't see.
And okay, now how about the free men? What would they do?
So they would be educated and could see.
Oh, but that, what's the theory again?
Knowledge is perception.
Would he be rejecting the idea that knowledge is perception in this passage?
Oh, no, he wouldn't.
Oh, what would he be saying?
Yeah, he is. Yeah.
But?
Yeah. He's got two kinds of seeing.
He got two kinds of
seeing. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. All right, okay. Back to the point around the moment.
Thank you.
Okay, before we have the sentence from Sandy about knowledge and wisdom, didn't we? Barbara,
mm-hmm.
My translation, which is according to, is different. For to know this is wisdom and excellence of the genuine sort. Mm-hmm. Not to know is to be manifestly blind and base.
They have gnosis is Sophia and truly arete.
Yeah.
Right? So I don't know, it's not in the infinitive form here, that's what you're
therefore, yeah.
Getting at.
What are you getting at?
Not in the to know that is, yeah. But rather the state of knowing.
State of knowing. And it's gnosis.
Uh-huh. It's gnosis. Yes. And it's interesting, blind and base is curious, is it they use the noun for not seeing, anoia, right? Is amatheia and kakia, from kakos,
mm-hmm.
That kind of thing.
Explain.
Gnosis is a noun from ignoma, meaning to know. And so what we're talking about was whether or not it was to know, but it's not, it's a state of knowing. And arete is the word for excellence that comes up in the Nina. And so he's saying knowledge of this is Sophia wisdom and true, there's a word for true in there, it's arete, derivative. True virtue. Ignorance of this, or the not knowing of this, is unlearning, and bad. Yes.
Ignorance
of
wisdom. So then wisdom is a kind of knowledge.
Very
rude.
So wisdom is a kind of a particular self.
Yeah. I'm glad you mentioned that because Barbara was going to give us a talk on the difference between the two. See, there's one word in both sections. Knowledge. Knowledge and wisdom. Knowledge. And she knows that those two words are different, even though the same English word is covering it.
What are the two words, gnosis?
And epistemon.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we've worked a little bit. We're going to launch into a brief, but you know, usual confidence.
And then she realized that she really had a lot of work to do.
Well, is gnosis, what's the word for wisdom?
Alas.
Sophia, that's solid.
Sophia.
Yeah, that's solid.
But there's a certain type of knowledge. It's knowledge of this, and there's of this particular subject is wisdom. So knowledge of something is wisdom. Of a certain thing. Okay. But knowledge of it is a, that means the object and the knower and the known together are wisdom, right?
Oh, yeah, well, there's a whole development of this concept of gnosis, you know, gnostics end up, same word, gnostics, knowing. It's a personal knowledge, it's a seeing knowledge. It's a state of knowing, it's a state of mind. The other kind is not. Because the way he defines it, it's mathematics, it's factual. To a great extent, it's dependent upon memory.
And logical methods.
Yeah, logical.
You said it was the state of knowledge.
Whatever you're going to do with gnosis, what do you do with it?
State of knowing.
The state of knowing.
Yeah.
Is wisdom. Okay.
Okay.
Rather than the knowledge of this is wisdom, assuming that this.
So there's something. We don't have a word.
We don't have a word for it. We have one English word covered for it. They have at least three.
Even if we
No, we don't.
You can forget it. We don't have a word for it. Because we can't call it the knowledge that we can't call it.
See, the kind of knowing that Theaetetus is learning, which is called knowledge, right? Is geometry,
harmony, astronomy.
It's hilarious.
All in harmony.
Now, when Plato or Socrates is using this word, English word, it's not. It's another kind of. This kind of stuff can be episteme.
But in some place he calls it understanding, isn't he?
That's yet another one, yeah. Also learning is different.
Yeah.
Right, okay. Would you agree in any case this word in this section does not include the same subject matter?
Certainly does.
Clearly. Right. So, I'm going to put a bracket around it. The knowing of this and I'm going to call that 176 B to D for a moment. This kind of knowing, or gnosis, right? That's this. But he, right, it's only got one eye, he thinks this is. And therefore, he takes on certain airs and certain styles and certain manner. Because he treasures this, because that can be the basis for him projecting all kinds of models and attitudes and acts together.
Right.
He cannot see this. He's blocked from seeing that. Doesn't see that. Does it? From the quote that you just read. He doesn't know it's there, he doesn't see it. He's uneducated to this, right? He's uneducated to this. Can't see it. Blind to it.
Socrates is blind to that?
No. No, this is the Socrates.
Oh, that's the
song. Yeah, this is the song. See?
But I just wonder why Socrates has a question.
Oh, that's right.
Socrates has a question.
Yeah, why does he have a question?
No, who?
Socrates.
Well, let me put this for, I just wanted to put it for Socrates.
You can't see the value of B.
Right. Let's put Socrates over here now, all right?
You can't see the value of B and not C.
Now, I'm going to figure it out together. Socrates calls this, he calls this wisdom. That's wisdom.
What's he calls wisdom?
Knowing this, that's wisdom. But he is, would you not agree, he looks at this and he says, nope, I'm puzzled about that. He's puzzled about that.
Of whether it falls into the class of knowledge, is that what he's puzzled about?
Well, he's reviewing a position, and many people, especially the sophists, would say that knowledge and wisdom are the same thing. He says, you know what? I'm puzzled about this, about what this knowledge is. That's this stuff.
Oh, okay.
I'm puzzled about that.
Oh, he knows it's not knowledge, but he knows that wonders what it is.
Yeah, what is it? I'm puzzled about that stuff. Give me a reason why I'm puzzled, he says. We'll go first. But he's not, would you agree, he's not puzzled about this.
No, he lays out, they're pretty clear. Okay.
There's no puzzlement about that. And the whole dialogue is nothing other than to make this point clear. Here's the issue of the dialogue.
He's puzzled about episteme and not gnosis.
That's true, but the dialogue starts on this question. Mm-hmm. He says, well, you know what?
When they first formulate that question in the dialogue, do they use episteme?
Yes. Yes. That's 148, wasn't it?
145.
146. Yeah, 146A, 145, right.
Could you apply what you were talking about a few times ago about an art to knowledge and wisdom? You know, the would it benefit you? What are the different points?
This doesn't benefit.
Right.
This digression is trying to point out the difference between these two. This benefits, this doesn't. Mm-hmm. Therefore, this can be the basis of an art, this cannot.
Okay.
Right? It's curious, right, isn't it? Let's go back a moment. Look. I'm running still on the same point of Gnosis, right? All other forms of seeming power and intelligence and the rulers of society are a mean, right? Are as mean and vulgar as the mechanic's stone handicraft. All other forms of seeming power and intelligence. They're all mechanics. All other forms of seeming power and intelligence, and the rulers of society are as mean and vulgar as the mechanic's skill and handicraft. As a man gains knowledge of such skills, he may give the air have an attitude of knowing, and so make others consider that he is a man of knowledge. But in truth, it's only a pose, a role, an act that he plays before an assembly of fools. And when they applaud this kind of knowledge, they don't know that they're dealing with shadows and living like men in a cave. How's your translation? No kidding. Well, it's getting late, maybe mine.
Yeah. You can pose it, I bet others do.
Yeah, that's what it is. How's yours?
Part of the cave?
Like in the cave?
Yeah. What do you think? I'd make it up?
What page is that? I have a corner.
Yeah.
Oh. That was so different.
No, it didn't seem genuine. Well, how else do you judge whether it's in there or not? You're not going to check with Rhonda, are you, just because she bought a similar copy, though mine was cheaper.
$1.45.
Sure.
No wonder it's screwed up. Caves and stuff. What's this about me kicking and spraying?
Well,
it
okay, what I do, I would like to read it. To the end of that, because there's a point that I want to turn to. All other forms of seeming power and intelligence in the rulers of society are as mean and vulgar as a mechanic's skill and handicraft. The man's words and deeds are unrighteous and profane. Yet best not persuade himself that he is a great man because he sticks at nothing, glorifying his fame, as men do when they fancy that others say of them, they are no fools, no useless burdens to the earth, but men of the right sort to weather the storms of public life. Let the truth be told. They are what they fancy they are not. All the more for deceiving themselves, for they are ignorant of the very thing it most concerns them to know, the penalty of injustice. See, the difference between these two groups hangs on that point. That's the difference. Let the truth be told. They are not what they fancy they are. They are. Right? Let the truth be told. They are what they fancy they are not. All the more for deceiving themselves. Why? For they're ignorant of the very thing it most concerns them to know. See, it's an ignorance. The difference between those two groups, it's not inborn, it's not that one's good and one's bad. It's a particular kind of ignorance. Right? So
yeah, one is appearing also. One is appearing to be clever.
Yeah, but the root of it is they're ignorant of just one thing.
Right. They're ignorant of what they think they're not ignorant of.
They don't know what they'll pay for not knowing.
They don't know what they'll pay for not knowing. Right? That's the key. That's right. They're ignorant of only one thing. Of the consequences of their ignorance. Right?
They're thinking you know when you know.
They're ignorant of something. Let the truth be told. They are what they fancy they are not. All the more to deceive themselves. They are ignorant of the very thing which concerns them to know. The penalty of their lessons. That's it. What penalty is that? It's their dark. Oh, it's just the other two powers. Well, then this is what they're ignorant of. And all through this, there's one word that keeps coming up. What's the word? Injustice, isn't it? It's all through this.
This is unrighteousness.
Right. Injustice, injustice, injustice.
Unrighteous here.
Yeah.
Unrighteous?
So in yours it'd say that God is in no matter and unjust, right? Is that what yours would say? God is in no wise and in no matter.
His translation doesn't even say God, it says the Father.
All right. But I'm just saying, the word here in ours is unrighteousness. Or unrighteous. Unrighteousness. Know the penalty of unrighteousness.
Oh, unrighteousness? That's better, really.
And therefore...
That's much better than the word justice.
Yeah, because...
Yeah, right. Because in modern society, the idea of justice is...
That's
legal.
Courts and stuff.
Court and legal.
Yeah.
The Greek word is clearer than that, right? Dikaiosyne. Mm-hmm. It's righteousness. Huh. Like the title of the Republic, isn't it? You know, the secondary title of the Republic is righteousness.
Righteous?
No, not justice.
What?
They translate it as justice.
Hmm.
What's the primary title?
Republic.
Oh, yeah.
Glad it's done. Okay.
Couple slaps in the face. Cold water.
What's the primary title of the Republic?
Who was buried in grass today?
Where are you? Here now.
Maybe you're setting too far back.
Yeah, where
is it? George Washington's first name.
Do you know
Harry? What?
What it describes is the shining pattern in Book 6, and it talks about it being energeis. Mm-hmm. In the, that's the same term that's being used. Shining pattern, right? And that's the same word that's being used for the quote that we just did about.
No.
Ignorance of it is folly or manifest wickedness. It not to know when we had knowledge of this is wisdom or true virtue. I'm sorry, 129 at 176 C5, where we're talking about gnosis is sophia. Mm-hmm. That ignorance is folly or manifest wickedness, and manifest is that same term, which is a very strange place for it to come up. You know, manifest is in our gates. And it's like, what? And can you see the term in the Greek?
Yeah.
Okay, so what was curious to me is that then he's saying two patterns, two paradigma are set up in the world, the divine and the godless. Mm-hmm. And it seems as if the way he's using this term, that both of those patterns are visible. Can I use that word? I'm using it kind of weakly, yeah. But I'm playing off the idea that the point was made with Nancy of the idea that they're perceptible and of the fact that the definition in the Republic of the musician goes back to being able to perceive those patterns.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So those things all went clicking together, so I thought I would point that out. For some reason, which I have now forgotten. Like Nancy.
And Stepper, but you forget the reason for it.
Unrighteousness. Oh, because it all goes back to nature of justice and injustice, and patterns of justice and injustice, which is why I brought that up as being two patterns, one of which was just perceivable. But why would they both be shining? That's kind of puzzling.
Shining? Is that the word you're
Yeah, well, that's, I'm using it as shining, because, but they you can translate it, they give it as visible, say, primary meaning, visible, in bodily shape. As primary meaning for anargos. Argos is a word for like fire. So, and they, but they use it as visible, which is a kind of common realm of meaning for Greek terms of light. It's words for appearance often have to do with coming into light, out of darkness into light. But so it plays off that knowledge is perception. When you have the knowledge, when you're educated, it becomes perceptive.
You didn't make that very strong, Laura.
I can't figure out what the fuck I wanted to mention it for at all. I was thinking, what sticker? What the hell did I bring that up for?
No, No, I think you have a good point.
I can't figure out what
the only thing is,
what the hell are you doing?
The point is,
so what? So the book is green. No.
Wait a minute. Hold on. Wait a minute. You started out, you know.
Manifest, right?
I thought it was rather convoluted, what you did there.
That's true, it was very convoluted.
Let me see if I can say
it. I lost myself in it.
Okay, let's see if I can say it.
Not what I call it.
You started out one way and ended up that both of the patterns seem to be visible, or, as you said, perceptible. And then somehow you slipped this, which I didn't know about, the bright and shining part in there, and you're holding that kind of in the background, right?
Mm-hmm. That was the most puzzling part to myself.
But you didn't bring that out, see, until, well, you know, I was down near the end.
I thought I mentioned it at the very beginning, too.
About
is
bright?
Is that the only
about shining.
Huh? Is that the only way to translate? Go ahead, Billy.
Well, what I'm trying to say is so then you, then as you were thinking as you went along and you brought it back to this episteme, right, and gnosis, where there's two kinds of knowledge, right?
Yeah.
You did that.
Uh-huh.
I don't think I can say it.
Yep, I can't either. I wish I could.
I mean, you got some points there, and I was trying to put them together.
They're multiple, though. Maybe that's the problem.
Is in part, is that in?
In our gaze.
In our gaze, is it bright and shining, or is there other? You mentioned fire also.
Well, see,
a kind of fire.
You know, what's funny is the, not funny. The only meanings given in the Thick Lexicon are visible. That's the first meaning. I'm reading from it. I have it in front of me, okay? In case you wonder if I'm making it up here.
Yeah.
Visible, palpable, in bodily shape, and it's used of gods who appear in their own form. Okay. Visible form, the second meaning, manifest to the mind's eye, distinct. Okay, in our language it means distinct or manifest. But when you look at the roots, that's where it gets that meaning of shining, because that's what the word literally means. Okay? And they're saying it doesn't function that way. That's why they're translating it visible, etc. But when you get a god appearing in his own form, and they're going to translate that as visible, yeah. But with that kind of context of meaning, a god is numinous, I would think.
Where is that word?
I mean, if someone had a translation where they're translating a luminous and numinous bastard.
That's contradictory.
Really? Really?
It's inappropriate there.
Yeah. Well,
if you use those terms, you shouldn't say bastard. It's completely unimportant. Right? You have to say that the person has transcended the origin of this verb, as it were.
Okay.
And, it's inappropriate. And he's tying this word with the lowest word.
It appears so. Mm-hmm.
In Greek.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, to say like a divine splendor of wickedness, you'd say, would you mind going back over that thing?
Because
that's what he's got.
That's right, that's what Barbara was saying.
That's
was
the point you're making.
Yeah.
Right. Manifest wickedness.
Or we shouldn't invest that much meaning in that word and correct our understanding of the sixth book, and that's what's at stake.
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Or that there's much in that he's using perception in two different ways. And maybe other words that he, other words that he can use interchangeably, depending on what region he's using, talking about. Like he may be able to use the same word in different regions, but we have to understand how they're functioning.
Yeah, that's true. How does that help us?
Well, I don't know how it would be functioning given that, but it, in that he was using perception in early on in one way, and then perception could be done that those who are uneducated means that they don't perceive a certain region or a certain they don't have a perception of a certain knowledge. He's using the same word, perception.
Yeah, that's true. Now do it. We're saying, since he's using the idea of perception the way in which we described a few minutes ago, why don't you use that as the model for here?
Right.
So go ahead and do it.
Well, I'm not able to do it. I'm just bringing up that, that to present that as a model to maybe understand it, but I don't
have it. It's not a model yet.
Well, I'm offering it, but I don't know how to do it. I don't know how to work with it at this point. I'm just offering it.
No, you're not offering it. No, wait, pardon. Hey, look, please, right? I'm not putting it down, so don't do that. Flicker, if you're offering a model, then someone should be able to use it and explore it. You're offering a possibility. Well, no, a model is like, it is what? It's something to use as an analogy and push it out. But what you're saying is, there may be an analogy there. I don't know if there is one. But in terms of what we did just a few minutes ago, there were two ways of dealing with something. And that may be the way of going here, but I don't know how to do it.
Oh, that's what I said.
Yeah, that's not a model.
Oh, I didn't.
Okay, but what?
Okay.
It might be interesting to take that as a possibility.
That it's used.
That it, yeah. That it does have that impact.
On a person who perceives it.
Yeah.
I always found it equally puzzling that they would say about the musician that he would perceive both justice and its opposite. Remember?
It has to be opposite to all those things.
Not perceive.
No, observe.
Well, what were you saying, Peter?
Wasn't it? Observe? Yeah. Must be able to name.
I mean, so I was trying to figure out what the source of my own puzzle, and then maybe I had another puzzle. That could be part of it. If I can't see it in the quote about the perfect musician, that he would have to see the opposites of the virtue, as well as the virtues in great and in small. But
so, you know, what he has still. Thank you.
Okay.
So he's giving all of this. Christ is giving all of these things we just listed for each of these people. And he's saying the difference between the two of them is that this one is what? This one is wrong.
I wasn't paying attention.
Okay, this is the sophist. This is the philosopher. And there are two patterns, aren't there? Does this pattern of the sophists depend upon an ignorance?
Right. Ignorance of it is fine.
An ignorance of something. Of what?
The penalty of unrighteousness.
Of
right.
The penalty of
unrighteousness.
And over here, aren't they knowledge of the consequences of
righteousness,
of knowing this. So it's a knowledge of righteousness. What's the liquor? What is it specifically? What is it he has to know? Specifically, what is it? What does he have to know? What's he got to know?
That God is in no wise and in no manner unrighteous?
No. No. Yeah, yeah, that's just close to my mind.
That's a good question. For knowledge of this, is this my true vision?
Well, what's the this?
Yeah, what is the this? That's a good question.
That's what I thought the this was.
Pursue virtue.
I thought it was
the true reason to pursue virtue.
Hmm. And you would say?
But the true reason is to become godlike.
Yeah.
Other
reason
for
that. Yeah, that's where it is. That's where it is. Okay. What is it though you have to have knowledge of? That's a consequence.
Oh, is it gotta be, is it as simple as that one before the colon?
I don't know. Go ahead.
It is herein that the true cleverness of a man is found, and also his worthlessness and cowardice, for the knowledge of this is wisdom.
Well, what's the knowledge? What's the knowledge of righteousness? What's he talking about? Something secret? Look here. Look at this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 letters. So you know it's profound. Right? Anything over 8? Golden West College is considered the 12. Remarkable. So what do you have to know? Knowledge of this righteousness. What do you got to know?
Knowledge of this is wisdom and true virtue.
Yeah, don't read. Okay, tell me. Because if you read, you'll stumble across. Some deep thing is the next paragraph. It's a shallow thing. It's a shallow thing.
It's a barbaric bog, right?
I have good reason to know that. Okay. But there is one thing about the softness. When you get them alone and make them explain their objections to philosophy, then if they are men enough, face a long examination without running away. It's all right. How they end by finding their own arguments unsatisfying. Somehow their flow of eloquence runs dry, and they become as speechless as anything. Well, if you can get one, if you can get one to sit and to talk, you know what? It doesn't take much. They'll see that they've been slipshod in their reasoning, pragmatic in their approach to life. You know, they know. They're not evil, see? They're not evil. It's a veneer. But the consequences are profound. Is that what you're saying? What's he doing in the digressional? If we just stay here for a while, what's he doing in the digressional? This is Theodorus. What's he doing? How has Theodorus been in this whole dialogue?
Spectator, warrior. He was forced to fight with. I mean, mm-hmm. He was forced to get into it. He's still the teacher of all these young men standing around, and they're accepting that this is knowledge. What he does. He certainly might change his ways, and therefore he would change what he teaches, or the way he goes about it.
Well, is Socrates doing it in the digression?
Yeah, he's making him stay and talk.
Yeah, right?
He finally says, yeah, can't get away from you, son. Strip and fight.
He thinks he's all good.
Flicker. Go back to this question. Way back that we had, way back then. It's knowledge and wisdom, the same thing. Yes, that's why I'm puzzling. Puzzled about this. The digression. And what do we find? Does he tell you what wisdom is?
Mm-hmm.
Tell you what wisdom is? Does he tell you what he considers knowledge?
Mm-hmm.
That's true, too.
On the different levels? Is he taking Theodorus through it?
Sure.
Well then, what goes on in what goes on here?
He picks up the discussion that he wanted to have Theodorus to be in.
He's been doing it all the time.
That's true.
He's been doing it because he's been attacking his view of knowledge. It isn't finished, yeah.
He's been talking to Theodorus through the ideas via discussion. Tiger.
So Sock's puzzlement in there.
Mm-hmm.
It's not actual puzzlement to himself, but it's a puzzle as to how other people are thinking about what knowledge is. Is that?
Well, yes.
But she's not really puzzled about the difference between knowledge and wisdom.
This kind of knowledge or this kind of knowledge?
The difference between the two.
No.
He's not puzzled about that.
But he can be puzzled about this.
Puzzled as to what it is?
That's right.
Like, how can it be a copy, or in what form could it be?
Yes, both.
How does it get there?
Both.
It's not really true, but it's an appearance.
It works and does a lot.
Yeah, it's a reflection. How does it reflect?
But it sure is curious, isn't it?
It's got a lot of power.
And when you examine it, there's no philosophical position. You see, one of the problems he has is this one. If there is such a thing as this, in this sense, the popular one, then you should be able to take all the different kinds of it and find some general idea of what knowledge is, shouldn't you?
But it's always changing.
That's true. It does change.
And there's a different bunch of subjects, and there's...
Yeah. But any attempt to try to define this by finding its common elements throughout this whole thing, he's going to show is doomed to failure. But there's no question about the fact that you can do a lot with this, that which isn't.
Yeah, that's right. Geometry.
I mean, it's a lot. It's real curious. It's very curious stuff. Yeah,
you build pyramids and stuff.
Yeah, hey, it's a, ooh, boy, that's really make curious coffee. Stuff.
Yeah, sculpture.
Make coffee.
Sculpture and stuff like that.
It's really amazing. It's really very curious stuff. And that's what he's going to get us to see. That every definition of this stuff is going to just fall apart.
Yeah,
and
but
there's no doubt that it has power.
Yeah.
It manifests itself. It has some kind of
it's
manifestation. And when you're in it, you think you're really you're great.
It generates a pattern. But it isn't. But how can it generate a pattern?
If it isn't.
Yeah.
It's real curious stuff.
Does that mean something comes from nothing?
It's really weird. And that's what we have to get to. Well, we haven't finished the digression. What time is it?
10 o'clock.
10 o'clock? Good.
Take a break.